And welcome to the valedictory function of the biology orientation cum selection camp of 2018. This is the first part of the valedictory function where we traditionally have a lecture by a scientist. And today we are very pleased to have among us Professor Roop Mallick from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. I will give a more detailed introduction of Professor Mallick later in the formal function. I just welcome Professor Mallick to give his lecture now.
Thank you, Anvesh. Thank you, Anvesh, for having me here. And I, before I begin, I do want to congratulate you on the fantastic service that you are doing by coordinating these Olympiads. It's a lot of work, and it's well appreciated. So I have no particular plan for this talk. It is kind of going to be a mix of, you know, like a story. And but the theme will revolve around the theme will revolve around. Can you hear me easily? Yeah. Okay. Then I'll move around. The theme will revolve around what we will see are kind of machines, and some of them are shown here. And I will try to tell you a little bit more about them as we go on. Now, all of you would be aware of this movie. I'm sure most of you have seen it. There have been many, many versions of this, and there's a new one, Jurassic World, coming in. And this is by Michael Crichton. But probably some of you may also have read about this novel written by the same author, Michael Crichton, where he talked about these solar-powered nanobots. Each one of these dots is a nanobot, which can organize into many kinds of structures, and you know, and then they prey on, you know, various people, and it gets quite horrific at the end. But when I have read both of these, and I find this to be much more interesting, you know, than actually this movie. But it didn't get so much publicity anyway. But what I want to say is that small, you know, if you look at each of these individual things, is really where the action is in many situations in nature. And yeah, so the business end is at very, very small dimensions. And, you know, I mean, of course, this dimension can vary, but I'm talking about, you know, things happening on the scales of nanometers and microns, and probably even less than that. And that's where we are going to be for most of the you know, next 1 hour today, at the size scale of molecules, which exists at nanometers and, you know, of that scale. Now, many of you may be aware that the Nobel Prize in Chemistry a few years ago was awarded to people, you know, these three gentlemen. They shared this Nobel Prize who, you know, made something which is shown as a cartoon here. And using the chemistry, which we will not go into right now, at these size scales. And if you run this movie, you will see, I mean, it doesn't look so dramatic, but basically something like this is moving around, and you are imaging it using an electron microscope because it is, of course, so small. But what people have been trying to do is that they've been trying to make very tiny machines, which hopefully in the future we can, you know, probably use for clinical or other kinds of applications, where you have to provide some fuel. In this case, you can, you know, shine light on and off, and let us say these molecules here, let's not get into the details of that, they, depending on whether they see light or not, they will undergo a structural change, okay? And when they do that, in repeated cycles of on, off light will, you know, rotate these wheels, and this thing will move around. Now, as we see all this, of course, they are inspired by nature, actually, okay? And you know, so this, you know, when this wheel is turning, there is some equivalent of a molecule here, and these are benzene rings, where if you shine light, this thing rotates in the way shown by this arrow. And, you know, this, you know, rotational motion, because of shining of light, changing of pH, changing voltage, various kinds of, you know, things can, you know, be harnessed to get this thing to move around, like what you saw in the previous slide. Now, of course, this is motivated by what is happening to you as, you know, you watch me, you know, give this talk here, because you know that in your eye, in your retina, you have these kinds of, you know, rhodopsin complexes, where you have proteins bound to a molecule here in the this is a lipid membrane, and we will talk a little bit more about lipids here. later in the talk, where you have this molecule called retinal, some version of this, which when you shine light, you know, it undergoes a cis-to-trans conformation, and that is, it leads to a change in this entire complex, and that is registers as, you know, signal as something you have seen. So these machines already exist in nature, and we are trying to make versions of this, but our success till now is, you know, of course, nowhere near what nature has already implemented. So as we go on, I will move to what these natural machines are and how we can study them, how we can understand them, how strong are they, what do they do. And one of the themes which I particularly is very close to what I like to do is that, you know, you will immediately understand that these machines are on the size scales of nanometers, and but, you know, me and you are on the size scale of meters, right? So the kind of, you know, things that these machines do, they must add up somehow so that you can see things happening over the size scale of meters. Like when I talk, in my vocal cords, there are vibrations. That's why, you know, I can generate a sound. And that is actually because of these kinds of machines. When I move my hand, that same thing is happening. But one molecule doing something is not going to bring out so much sound or allow me to move my hand. So how do these machines cooperate in large numbers to, you know, do things that you and me are very familiar with is something very close to my heart, and maybe we will be able to talk about that. Now, as we talk about machines, I will kind of keep myself restricted because of the shortage of time to proteins. Now, DNA, I mean, there are different kinds of molecules. When we are talking about nature, I'm talking about biology, and this is the biology Olympiad, so let us stay at biological molecules. We will talk about proteins. You can also think about DNA as machines. You can think about other kind of structures. But largely, you know, overwhelmingly largely, the machines that exist in, you know, in your body are actually proteins, okay? And all of you know, I don't need to go through this in detail, that proteins consist of a chain of amino acids. And these amino acids can be, you know, 20, 21 different types, as you see here. And some of them like water, some of them don't like water. And whenever we talk of biology, we must remember that everything is happening underwater, okay? So now, depending on the sequence here, some parts of this protein may wind up like this. Why? Because at a particular repeat frequency, there are amino acids, let's say, which don't like water. And there are amino acids then also which like water. So if you make such a structure like a spring, the amino acid side chains which like water can project out, and the ones which don't like water can stay inside the spring, where, you know, you have some exclusion of water inside this tube. And similarly, you can have, you know, you can have, so these are like alpha helices. All of you are familiar with this term in protein science? Yeah. So these are alpha helices, these are beta sheets, and there can be other structures like this. But the main point that I, because we were talking about machines, the importance of this is that you can actually, it actually works like a spring in many situations. You can store potential energy inside that, okay? And inside such a structure or inside these kind of structures, and you can store energy and release it when required, okay? And so that is why this is a machine. So that is what you're all familiar with. Let us say you think about a catapult. Okay, think of it as a machine. You're going to pull this, and you're going to store energy in it, and then you release it, and then, you know, you will shoot something from that. So, that's what machines do many times, right? They store energy in some way and dissipate in some other way, and that's something like that you can also do here. And of course, you know, I don't need to go into this. There are many kinds of more complicated structures inside proteins, and it is not easy to understand how this kind of a machine would work, okay? How something will bend here and that will create something, do something here. So that's obviously not easy to understand. And but there are ways in which people have tried to do that. And one of the things you can do is that if you want to understand, you know, what does this part of the machine do, you can take help of something wonderful called recombinant technology, where you can use molecular biology to change some residues inside that, okay, and maybe, you know, disable this spring. So if this spring is not working, what happens to the whole machine? You can ask these kind of questions, okay? So, by the way, you can interrupt me at any time, all right? I'm happy to answer. And this is one example. If you can think of it as a machine, again, remember that the sizes we are talking about are typically less than 100 nanometer, 10 nanometer, 20 nanometer. That is the kind of sizes we are talking about. And this, everybody knows what this is, right? This is hemoglobin either having oxygen or not having oxygen, depending on where it is in your body, in your lungs, or in some other part of your body. And you know, you can see that it, depending on oxygen is bound or not, this, you know, structure changes. So you can think of this as a machine which undergoes this kind of, you know, routine periodic transformations to do its job, which is to deliver oxygen where it is needed. Now, it is important when you think about biology to think about the physical aspects of things as well, and yes, of course, the chemical aspects. So I will try to, you know, do that a little bit. Now, if you were going to, what is it like to be a machine? Now, you know that if you have seen, have all of you seen something like a lathe machine? Have you heard of what a lathe machine is? It's in this workshop. You have this, you know, to machine things. You have, you know, a large machine, okay? Now, these machines are much smaller, obviously. And if I am standing, if you think of me as a machine, whether the fan has been turned on or not doesn't matter to me, okay? But if for these machines, the kind of, you know, quote-unquote wind, thermal vibrations, all of these things matter a lot, because at those size scales, these, you know, the thermal noise itself is of the order of the energy scales involved with these machines, okay? So you know that thermal noise is measured in terms of Boltzmann constant into temperature, right? And the typical energies, and, you know, thermal energy is, you talk about as KBT, okay? Boltzmann constant into absolute temperature. And the typical energies at which, energy scales at which these molecules work are of the order of, you know, 5 to 10 KBT, sometimes actually even lesser. So they are not that much higher than the thermal noise around it. So it's quite remarkable that they can actually work, even being so close to the thermal, thermal background. So obviously then you can ask many questions, and I will come to specific examples of machines. Why should you, you know, as I told you, people got the Nobel Prize for building, trying to build these kind of machines. Why does one want to build them? How does society benefit? These are, you know, questions of the future. And I don't have that quote here, but so to answer this, you know, I read a very interesting quote. Somebody had said, I forgot the name of the gentleman, but if you today ask why are we building some nano machines, then it would be like asking, you know, whatever, 1,000 years ago when primitive man made the wheel, asking them, why are you making the wheel? Okay, it is something like that. Okay, so now because somebody made a wheel, we have highways, we have Ferrari cars, and you have bullet trains. Okay, so and that's the kind of motivation why build them. But the implications are obvious. If you can program a machine like this to deliver a drug inside a body at a particular, you know, organ of interest, then, you know, that would be fantastic, and people are actually trying to do that. Now, there can be different, now when we now start talking about machines, I want you to understand that we are talking about things that can generate force, okay, because that's what typically any machine has to do. They can generate force, and to generate, why is it important to generate force? Let us just try to understand it at a very kind of, you know, crude level. You all have, you know, seen, you know, images of cells where you have a nucleus, you have, you know, the Golgi somewhere like this, you have the endoplasmic reticulum spread out, then you have all kinds of, you know, vesicles here and there, and you can have mitochondria. So there is a, when you see a typical picture of a cell in your books or wherever you've seen it, there is an organization here, okay? And this doesn't happen automatically, because you're constantly have to fight against entropy to get this state where, you know, you organize things into different compartments. So if you don't fight entropy, if you don't burn energy to fight entropy, it'll all become a soup eventually, right? Just like what happens to your bedroom. Okay, if you don't maintain it, it becomes a mess. So that's what will happen here also. So there must be somebody who is constantly, you know, burning energy, okay, to keep all this organized like this. And unless the cell is organized like this, at a cellular level, I and you are not going to be organized like this, okay? So And where is that energy coming from? Who is doing that? That these are all important questions, and how is this organization maintained? And at least some of it, actually a lot of it, is maintained by the kind of machines that I am interested in, and I will come to that in a bit. But before that, this is one example of a machine. There can be two kinds of machines. You know that in your cars, you have rotary machines, right? You have rotary machines, your engine called an internal combustion engine, or nowadays there are electric engines. They basically rotate, and there is a gear tooth, right? There is a gear tooth that is coupled to an axle, and then you generate, your wheel rotates, and that's how you generate, but the wheel generates reaction against the ground, so you move forward, okay? So you can convert rotary motion to linear motion. That's what you're doing all the time in your car, okay? And that's what this bacteria also does in a different way. It basically has this propeller-like thing, flagella, they are called, and they have a small engine sitting there, which I won't go into right now. And that engine, it uses ATP. All of you know what ATP is, adenosine triphosphate. It uses ATP actually to turn this thing round and round. And when it turns, there is a reaction force against these helices as when they are turning, so you get translational motion. And this is important for the bacteria to live. There can be no life without motion. If it just sits at one place, where is it going to get food from, right? So it has to move around. All of you have heard of chemotaxis, right? So this is how it kind of runs around here. And now you can compare it to this machine here, okay? This is the propeller of a big ship, and this also turns around, so the ship moves. But there's a vital difference between this machine and this machine, which you should appreciate, is that in this world, where you are talking about the micron size scales or the nanometer size scales, there is nothing like inertia, okay? So in a ship, you know that, you know, all of you must have heard a big beeping horn from the ship needs a horn, right? Your car needs a horn, okay? It needs a horn. Why does it need a horn? Because it is not easy to stop quickly, right? You have inertia. Even if you brake, you will, you know, probably stop over those distance. And imagine a big ship. It can take kilometers to stop, okay? So in your world, where, you know, you're driving a car, you're yourself walking, or you push your friend, you are very used to inertia, okay? That if, for example, I go to the pool and I jump into the pool, I dive into the pool, I don't actually need to swim. I can almost cover half the pool, if it's not a very large pool, half the pool just by doing nothing. That is because I have inertia, okay? But suppose this bacteria jumps into a pool, nobody has ever seen it jumping into a pool, but suppose it jumps into a pool, it will go nowhere, okay? Because everything is dominated by viscosity, okay? So maybe you people should go back and look, there is something called the Reynolds number, okay? It is the ratio of, you know, viscous to inertial forces. Look that up into that, or inertial to viscous, I forgot which way. But basically, it quantifies whether you are going to be in the viscosity-dominated regime or you are going to be in the inertia-dominated. So whatever we are going to talk about now is going to be in the viscosity-dominated regime. It's called the low Reynolds number regime. Okay, for you and me, the Reynolds number can be maybe 10, 100, something like that. Okay, but for these guys, the Reynolds number is 10 to the power minus 5, 10 to the power minus 4, of that order. So, you know, it's very difficult to move around here. So the main point is that you need to constantly burn something and generate force to move. If you stop doing something, you can't move, okay? And that is exactly what these machines must do. They must constantly burn adenosine triphosphate or whatever other molecule, usually adenosine triphosphate, to move around. Otherwise, they can't go anywhere. They will just sit at one place. Maybe diffuse around, yes, but okay. So that was about these rotary motors. Now, there are other kinds of motors which are linear motors, okay? Now, when I do this, I am a linear motor, okay? Because I am, you know, walking in a more or less in a straight line. And you must have all seen this movie, I'm quite sure. Where this object is the machine here of our interest, and it this everything is immersed in water. Again, remember, this is happening inside a cell, okay? This is all immersed in water. And this distance from here to here is about 40, 50 nanometers, okay? So it's small again. And it is carrying something on its head, just like this guy here, okay? So this is this, this is this, but there's a difference that this guy walks in, you know, in air, obviously, like you and me, but this guy has to walk underwater. This guy, if somebody pushes it, him, you know, he has inertia. He or she has no inertia here, okay? So, now the important thing is that this, they are actually walking, they are not swimming here, okay, although they are underwater. Why are they walking? Because they require this, you know, long filament which is underneath that. Right, so you can see that it is, you know, it must be generating reaction force against this filament, like what you see here. Right. So it is basically doing something like this, and this is an enzyme. Okay, all of you know what enzymes are. This is an enzyme which has an enzymatic cycle, which means which has a chemical cycle where it, you know, burns a molecule, you know, removes a phosphate group from somewhere, does something somewhere, and it has this, it goes through this chemical cycle, but that chemical cycle is coupled to a mechanical cycle, okay? So therefore, it is a mechanochemical enzyme, and that mechanical cycle, because it is coupled to the chemical cycle, also repeats, okay? So what happens here is that every time it takes a step, one molecule of ATP is diffusing around, comes and binds here, okay? It gets chewed up, okay? It gets hydrolyzed. And that energy is used to bend a spring here, okay? And when that spring bends, it stores energy here. It will release by pushing this in one particular direction, and which direction I will come to that in a minute. And then you keep repeating that, and you know that's what you are seeing here in this cartoon. Now this is a cartoon, okay? It's not a real thing. Now, this is digressing a bit from this, but what we have been extremely interested in is something which not many people seem to be interested in, but is that this blue surface that you see here, okay, that is not, you know, it's very cool. When you see this movie, you just watch this motor doing thing, okay? But to us, what is cooler is actually this blue surface here, which consists of a lipid membrane, all right? And that lipid membrane is the surface on which all of these motors spend their lives, everywhere inside the cell, okay? How does this lipid membrane organize these motors? What are the mechanical properties of these lipid membrane? These are questions which we are very interested in, and maybe if I have the time, I will come to that. Are there any questions at this stage? No, everything is clear? Okay, so now, okay, please. Yeah, so I have no answer to that because this happened a long time back in evolution. But ATP, you know, that is actually not true. There are many machines which have evolved around GTP also, like you know, tubulin polymerizer. That is also like a machine, okay? But ATP repeats often and often because probably of its energetic properties. Because you know, and this is also true for GTP to some extent, because what you are doing in all these molecules is that you are packing three phosphate groups, and when you are doing that, you are putting in a lot of negative charge essentially. And to do that, you have to spend energy. This is not specific to ATP again, okay? And that energy is used to generate force later. Okay, so I have no answer if you ask me exactly why is ATP used and not a thing, but ATP and GTP are both used in different contexts. But this is an evolutionary thing. Okay, all right. So now here is a cartoon of a cell, and are all of you have heard about what microtubules are? All of you? Okay, so these are microtubules, and you can see a real version of this in this fluorescent image. This is a cell taken from underneath the skin of a frog, okay? And this is a, you know, a melanocyte, and you can see this beautiful radial structure. It looks like, you know, some supernova explosion or something, but these are all these microtubules, these straight lines here, and these microtubules have one end which is the so-called plus end, and the other end which is usually somewhere here, which is called the minus end, and they have an asymmetry. Okay, so this plus and minus is the fast growing end and is the slow growing end. But if you really look, if here closely, they are polymers. Okay, they are made up of this protein called tubulin. You take one tubulin, take another tubulin and join them like this. But importantly, there are two kinds of tubulins, alpha and beta, which are, so alpha, beta, and then there are protofilaments. This is a multi-lane highway. And these motors can recognize which is alpha and beta, okay? And that is how there are some which will move towards the beta end of the microtubule and some which will move towards the alpha end. And this is going to be important for what I'm going to tell you in a bit. So there is an asymmetry in this system, which is alpha is not beta, and they are arranged one after the other, and that's how, you know, this kind of organization arises inside the cell, because you have these filaments. Right, so you have these filaments, and you have to imagine alpha, beta along this, okay, and these motors can recognize them. And so now, if I run this movie, so no, let me run this movie first. Right, so this is, so these dots are herpes virus particles, which when I run this movie, you will see, this movie is sped up about 10 times or so. They are inside and the axon of a neuron, and they are moving in this, they're going to be moving in this manner, okay? So some are going this way, some are going that way, and there is no apparent order in this, okay? This is true for almost any kind of virus, any kind of bacteria that infects you, that this motion is driven by the kind of protein which I showed you here, and they're called motor proteins, okay? Almost all kinds of viral, bacterial, all kinds of pathogenic infections, they can hijack these motors, and that is how, you know, that is important for their life cycle, and I will come to that in a bit. Now, when you see this movie running, this is actually, the whole thing is 10 minutes, but so you will see all these black dots come to the center, and that's what you have seen here also. All the black dots are at the center here, okay? So each of those black dots here is a ball of, little ball of ink, okay? It's called a pigment granule, and these cells are underneath your skin, and your brain can send signals, cyclic AMP or the other hormone, I forgot. Basically, there are two kinds of signals by which you can either get all the ink balls to come to the center, or you can use them to go to the periphery, and that is how you know, the color of your skin can change, and you probably know that the chameleon uses this in a very nice way to change its colors. Okay, when it has to camouflage itself. And this motion actually is, when I run this again, if you look carefully, each of these granules is not just starting here and going to the center. Each of them is moving in a back and forth manner, but there is a net direction, that's why everything comes to the center. And this is the process which we and many others are trying to understand. Now, if you look here, imagine this as one of these ink granules. Here it is a mitochondria, but these things are true for both ink granules and mitochondria. What happens is that typically you have these kind of motor proteins, like I told you about kinesin. The one which I showed you in that movie is called kinesin. Kinesin comes from the word kin. Kin in Greek means to move, okay? And there's another class of, so kinesin is shown here in red, and there's a little arrow which shows you that kinesin generates force in this direction towards the plus end of the microtubule, which is typically towards the periphery of the cell, and the dynein generate force inwards, which is towards the minus end of the microtubule. And quite remarkably, almost all kinds of things which are moving around like this inside the cell, they have both kinds of motors attached to them, and so they both generate force, and that's why this thing moves in a back and forth manner, saltatory manner, and that, but eventually the cell can control whether dynein will dominate or kinesin will dominate. And in this case, dynein dominated, and that's why you saw everything going to the center at the end, okay? I can also give a different kind of hormone, and this movie will exactly run in reverse, and everything will go towards the periphery, and that is when kinesin is dominating. So there is a lot of interest in trying to understand how this opposing activity of these two kinds of motors is controlled, and that is also of interest to us. And remember that this opposing activity is important for generating this spatial organization, okay? The Golgi is here because it is bound to a microtubules which have dynein on it, and there is a lot of dynein activity on the Golgi which is keeping it here. The ER is spread out. These mitochondria can go wherever they want because, you know, where they are needed. Let's say, for example, a neuron is growing in a child's brain, okay? That neuron grows and it has to branch to build the entire network. At that branch, you have mitochondria has to be taken there. The energy has to be supplied there to, you know, build that branch, and that's actually what these motors are able to do. So I have about 15, 20 minutes more, right? Yeah, so I think I'm on time. So now we have also been trying to ask this question, and I will tell you a little bit about what we do. Now I will, what you are seeing here is a cultured cell, in this case a dictyostelium cell, okay? Dictyostelium is an amoeba, but you can basically do this experiment with any other cells also. And when I run this movie, you will see a lot of things moving around inside this, okay? And these are actually small plastic beads, roughly 1 micron size. So what we do is that we can grow these cells on a cover slip, on a microscope cover slip. They will grow happily and multiply. And then there is medium around that, water basically, with some nutrients. And you can purchase these beads from, you know, various places, and you add them to this medium, and these beads settle down after a while. And now these cells, you have these kinds of cells in your immune system also. They are your first line of defense against all kinds of infections. These are called macrophage cells, dendritic cells, you know, various cells of that family. Their job is to eat up whatever nasty things are coming in, okay? And they eat up bacteria, pathogens, diesel fume, diesel particle, what all these kinds of things in your lungs or in your other parts of your body. And those, when something comes from outside and is taken in, inside the cell, it is enclosed in a lipid membrane, okay? So this is, so imagine something good or bad, who knows, comes in. This is what will happen here. This object is here, and then eventually it will come here, okay, with this object still sitting inside. And this now quickly gets onto these microtubules, okay? Why? Because this, now if we zoom in here, there is a lipid membrane here, okay? It consists of phospholipids. All of you know this, it's very difficult to draw this, but basically a bilayer membrane. And to this, these motor proteins, these kinesins and the dyneins will attach, okay? How they attach and all that I can, you know, that's more complicated. I don't want to get into that. But when that happens, these guys start moving inside this, okay? And you see this happening. Now, what you can also do is that you can take these cells, you can burst them open, okay, by applying mechanical shear or by just changing the medium. And when you do that, and you can take these objects and put them on a single microtubule. So on this, in this picture, this is now outside a cell, this is inside a cell. I put them on a microtubule and they move like this, okay? And what you are seeing is real time. I have not sped it up at all. So this is happening at the, so these velocities are typically 1 micron per second. A 1 micron per second may seem small to you, but inside a cell it is pretty fast, okay? Because a cell is about maybe what, 30, 40 microns. So, you know, you can go from one end to the other. I mean, it doesn't work like that, but in fairly short time, okay? So, right. So, imagine these kinesin motors or the dynein motors attached to each of these objects, and, you know, they're doing their thing and, you know, you're moving. In this case, we only had kinesin motors. Therefore, they were all moving in one direction, but you can also do experiments where they are both, and then you will see this kind of motion. Now the important thing to appreciate, and this is an electron microscope image of them, they really exist. Okay, they don't just exist in cartoons, they are real, you can actually see them in an electron microscope. And they actually walk on stepping stones here, okay? And these stepping stones, why are they stepping stones? Because this feet cannot just land anywhere on this polymer. It has a particular place where the the local charges are correct for charge matching, shape matching between these two. And so they will just step on stepping stones. And these stepping stones are 8 nanometers apart from each other, okay? So 8, 8, 8, 8, and that's how it moves here. Now, this is important so let me just go back here. So let us talk a little bit about the kind of energies involved in this. As I told you that the amount of energy available from an ATP molecule, adenosine triphosphate, is a certain amount of energy is available, and that energy is approximately 100 piconewton nanometer. Now this is, all of you will know that this is a unit of force into distance, that is a unit of work, it is a unit of energy. Okay, you can convert this into joule or whatever you want. Piconewton nanometer here, okay? Why do I use piconewton nanometer? And I can also write this in terms of newton meter, but because the relevant forces are of the order of piconewtons. Pico is 10 to the power minus 12, okay? And nanometer is 10 to the power minus 9 meter, okay? Now, let us try to understand what kind of forces could these motors generate, okay? So the amount of energy you are putting into the molecule, the amount of maximum amount of work, suppose it was 100% efficient, the maximum amount of work it would do would be equal to this. It can't do more than that because that's how much you are giving it, okay? Now, what are the dimensions of these motors, okay? They are of the order of nanometers, tens of nanometers, 10 nanometers. So they can certainly never move than 10 nanometers. If you are yourself 1 meter long, how can you move 1 kilometer, right? So there one. So this number here is of the distance moved is typically of the order of 10 nanometers. I told you the distance between these stepping stones is 8 nanometers. That's approximately 10 nanometers. Then the forces are going to be of the order of 10 piconewtons, right? 10 into 10 will be 100. And this is actually 25 times thermal energy. Little bit here and there, approximately that much, okay? So, and they are not going to be 100% efficient, obviously, but they are remarkably efficient. So, probably you know that one of the most efficient cars that man has made is the Honda Accord, okay? And that has an efficiency of about 10%, whatever fuel it burns or how far it goes. 10% is the efficiency of a Honda Accord. These, you can calculate the efficiency, and I will show you how one can do that. These are about 40-50% efficient. In fact, some of the rotary motors are about 80% efficient. Okay, so that is quite remarkable. So now then you can measure the kind of forces that they generate. And by measuring the forces, these piconewtons, and by measuring the displacement, you can calculate how strong they are, how efficient they are, etc. And you can actually do much more. You can learn a lot of biology from this. So our interest is, of course, in the physics behind this, but our really main interest in understanding the biology. What does it do to your body and how do things matter? So what you can do here, and I will not go into the details of this, is that you can take these. So remember, I showed you these beads which are moving around inside cells. Though they were called phagosomes. Okay, maybe I should write here. So when this thing has gone in, this object is called a phagosome. So almost every kind of bacteria that goes into your body goes into a phagosome. Okay, and it is very important clinically to understand how the cell deals with this, and that's what we are trying to understand, because many kinds of pathogens can avoid what these motors do to them, and let's say, hope I have time to go into that. Anyway, what you can do is that you can take these phagosomes, for example, and you can pull them out of the cell and they move on that microtubule I showed you. You can act, and then So here is a cover slip, and you have stuck a microtubule on that, and from underneath you can shoot a laser like this, okay? And you put a lens here, which is typically the objective lens of your microscope, so you will focus this laser light somewhere. And this here, where you have a, so this is called a diffraction limited spot, okay, because this is diffraction limited optics, and this spot is typically roughly 500 nanometer to a micron of that width, okay. And in this diffraction limited spot, you can hold objects which are micron sized objects, okay. And these beads that I told you have 1 micron diameter, you can hold them over there. Now, and that's what you're seeing here. Now, what happens is that this laser light which is coming in from beneath is a constant stream of photons, right? So light consists of photons, and each of these photons goes in here, and when it sees this, you know, material which has a certain refractive index, so this the photon will deviate from its path, and the light will bend, like refraction, okay? And when the photon moves in a different direction, its momentum changes because the direction is changing. Because of this momentum change, there is an, because of Newton's law, there is an equal and opposite force, okay? And that force is like a small kick that each photon gives to this particle as it passes by, okay? And without going into more details, I don't have the time for that, you can show that this particle gets trapped in a field of light, in a gradient of light. So remember that there's more light here and less light as you go away because you focus the light there. And this, you can actually show that this particle is trapped in something called a harmonic potential. Have you all know what a harmonic potential is? It's basically, imagine taking a spring, a simple spring, and you pull it, okay? Pulling it a little bit is easy, pulling it more becomes difficult and difficult and difficult, okay? And if you see that, you know, so I've not written it here. Okay, so basically the amount of force that you have to exert is proportional to how much you pull it out within some regimes, okay? That's called the harmonic regime. And that, yeah, here it is. The proportionality constant is going to be, you know, some spring constant. There should be a minus sign here because it's in the opposite direction. But basically, this is a harmonic spring, and you can, when you pull it, you have to, now imagine that if I tie you with a spring to this wall, okay, and I ask you to move forward, initially it is easy to move, but as you go farther and farther, because this distance is increasing, the opposing force increases, the restoring force increases, and it will become difficult for me to go. Exactly that is happening to this motor here, okay? As it tries to move now more and more away, it can't move beyond a certain point because the restoring force is more than the maximum force this guy can exert, and then this detaches here, and then you fall back to the center again. And this will repeat and repeat, and this is the kind of data that you get from these kinds of experiments where you have time on this axis. This typically, you know, this could be about 10 seconds, 5 seconds or so, and this you have distance on the other side, this distance from the center of the trap, how far you have gone. And imagine a spring every time this is happening. Maybe I have a movie here. Yeah, there. This is a real experiment where this is one of those beads which is being, so imagine, remember the laser is like this, coming in like this, okay? And it is focused here and it is being pulled out by the motor, which you cannot see in this case. And when you do that, it goes out and then it will fall back. Okay, so you can do this kind of experiment and you can measure this displacement very precisely, and this is the data. Time versus distance, this distance is this distance, okay? And you get these kinds of plots, and here you can see if this is distance and this is time, then the slope is a velocity, right? And this slows down, obviously, because you have to do more work now against larger force, but you have to imagine a spring. You're stretching a spring every time, and you can see here this movement now is in steps. You can see these steps clearly, and these are 8 nanometer steps, okay? So these are the kind of experiments you do, but in reality, this is what the surface of that phagosome looks like, okay? There is not just motors. There's going to be, you know, many other things, as in biology all the time. And to make matters more complicated, you have both dynein motors and kinesin motors, which want to pull in opposite directions, existing on the surface of each phagosome, and varying numbers of that. We don't even know what those numbers are, okay? So To understand this complicated system is one thing that we do, and what we were shown 5 minutes, yeah. So what we had shown, if I go 5 minutes more, is it okay? Yeah. What we had shown a while back is that on each phagosome which was moving in that manner, you have this kind of an arrangement where you have many weak dynein motors in competition, and this is actually a tug of war. We could show that, okay? And I will show you this here. In competition against a single kinesin motor, this is like Superman here, okay? So this guy exerts about 5-6 piconewtons of force, and these exert significantly lesser force, 1 piconewton force. But then this, if you have more dynein, this is a force balanced tug of war, okay? Nature has not made a strong dynein. Okay, it has made multiple weak dyneins opposed to a strong kinesin, and who knows why, but an intelligent guess is because this process can now be controlled. Okay, you can add one dynein or remove one dynein and tilt the balance in one favor. If you had two strong kinesins, there would be not much opportunity for change, but we can only speculate on that. Okay, and if I run this movie, if it runs, you will see. So let me just, this is happening here. These two particles were one before this movie started, and they have now been stretched, and if you look carefully, there is a tube connecting them. Okay, so these are, in this case, these are, we have taken cells and we have just burst them open. Cells are taking in nutrients all the time, okay, from the outside medium, and these nutrients are liquid media, and they are enclosed in a small particle which has a membrane around it. It's basically food which is going to be degraded and digested. They are called endosomes, okay? And just like this is a phagosome, when you take in a solid particle. If I take in liquid nutrients, they are called endosomes, okay? Yeah. So, and this, you will see there is a tug of war happening. Can you see this membrane is stretched here? There, one gave up and the other will again pull. So this you can see this, and sometimes, and then finally it will go in one direction. There, this, okay, so this, you can see this happening, and this again, these are about half a micron or so, each of them inside, okay, anyway. So cutting a long story short, I can never remember what slide I have later. Okay, this is the last slide. Okay. So I will move on to the board a little bit now. And so the question that we have been interested in is that now, let us imagine that this board is a cell, okay? It is a macrophage cell in your body. It is part of your immune system. And suppose somebody comes in from outside. It could be a bacteria. It could be a mycobacterium. Mycobacterium tuberculosis, all of you know. Let's say a particle of mycobacterium comes in from outside. It will form an invagination like this here. It will come here. And this membrane here will bend like this, okay? And here is your bad guy. Eventually, it will be taken in, okay, because there is active force generated. So all of you know that this, you've heard of actin, right? So this cortex, this is the cortex of the cell. You have actin here, and there are motor proteins in that actin which pull and push those actin, and this eventually it breaks up, and you have something enclosed in a bilayer membrane here, okay? And this is, these are phospholipids here, and now there are, let's say the nucleus of the cell is here, okay? And this is the plus end of the microtubule because it's towards the periphery, and this is the minus end towards the nucleus. And on this, you have these, let me draw different kinds. You have these D, D, K, K, K. K means a kinesin and D means a dynein, okay? So you have both these kinds of motor attached to this. And this object will therefore, I don't have the movie here, it will move in a back and forth manner. Now what is quite remarkable actually is that this back and forth motion happens for approximately 10 minutes in most kinds of cells. Okay? Beyond a certain point, after 10 minutes pass, this back and forth motion stops, and this object now will go very rapidly towards the nucleus of the cell, where you have other things sitting, which are called, I'll have to draw again. Anyway, I hope you can see. So I will move away, okay? So you have things called lysosomes. Have all of you, do you heard of lysosomes? So lysosomes are, you know, the bad place in the cell where you get, you know, where, which are acidic and where you get degraded. So these cells want to take these pathogens to the lysosomes where they have to be degraded. That's how, you know, they will digest all these nasty things. And now, so there is some kind of a switch happening after some time, after which the dynein motors predominate, okay? And you rapidly take this thing here. Now, this switch is very important to understand because many pathogens can actually prevent this switch, okay? And by preventing that switch, they don't go here and they survive and they multiply, okay? So we have been very interested in this switch, and what we were able to show, I will not go into those details, is that it's a very unusual mechanism by which this switch happens, okay? How could this switch happen? That usually you would think that, okay, we will add 20 more dynes to this, okay? And then you will, you know, obviously go this way. Or we will remove the kinases. Now that doesn't happen, and you can actually show mathematically why that does not happen. I won't go into that right now. There is a simple surface area argument, because this contact area between this microtubule and this is limited, okay? Increasing the dynes or kinesins, you would require 10 to 20 fold more to do anything because the surface area is limited. Rather, what happens is that as you move around in this manner, you start accumulating cholesterol on this membrane, okay? Where does this cholesterol come from? Cholesterol comes from other organelles which are also moving around on this at the same time, and they fuse with each other. And so this object, after 10 minutes, has lots of cholesterol on it. And this cholesterol is a hydrophobic molecule. In this lipid membrane, there is, when the cholesterol increases beyond a certain amount, that cholesterol is like, imagine like having oil drops on water, okay? That oil coalesces and you start getting patches of cholesterol on this, and these are called lipid drafts, many of you may have heard, and the dynein motor actually likes this cholesterol, okay? So you get lots of dynein motors accumulating this cholesterol, and because this region is similar to the contact area between these two, if this rotates in a particular direction, remember there are other microtubules here, all of these dynein motors can actually generate force together because they are right at that place, okay? And they can take this here. Now, I will end by just, you know, bringing up one point, is that what I'm telling you here is that this dynein motor, if you put lots of them together, they seem to be able to work well together. That's how this thing is taken to the lysosome. This is actually not true for kinesin, okay? Kinesin, if you put lots of kinesin motors together, and we and others have done that, you cannot, you know, get much more out of this. You know, five kinesins will practically do what maybe one or one and a half kinesin done, but that's not true for dynein, okay? This dynein motor, if you take N motors up to a certain limit, of course, then the amount of force you generate, the time over which they can generate this force is N times the number, is proportional to N, okay? And we were able to show that nicely. And we have provided some evidence for why this happens. How can this motor, the dynein motor, work well in large teams? It seems like that every motor has an automatic gear mechanism inside it by which it can vary its velocity depending on how hard you pull it back. And so if you have a team of four dynins going, the one at the front, when it sees a load from behind, maybe by kinesin or by something else, it can rapidly shift to lower gears and slow down and wait for the ones which are the back, which are in higher gear, which are coming faster, to bunch together mechanically. And that's how they can because when they are close together, they can share mechanical load better. And that may be one reason by which this kind of having a gear-like ability allows them to work in large teams. And it is also intriguing that many processes in nature which require large forces actually use dynein, although dynein is a weaker motor than kinesin. Okay, so probably because it can work well in teams, but we'll have to see that. I will stop there, and I guess I'm on time. And I would like to acknowledge these people. Some of their names are missing, who actually do all the hard work while we come and talk.
Questions? Questions from students?
It's Sunday morning.
Sir, here you explained that in the before the switch, it comes here towards the nucleus. So, sir, for the coming towards the nucleus, the dynein should be more, right?
Yeah. So that's what. It doesn't quickly come to the nucleus. It spends some time going back and forth, where they have both equal activity. Okay. But then after a certain time, this cholesterol accumulates and the dynein clusters, and that's when things change.
So your previous slide said that vesicular transport is like a coin tossing experiment.
Yeah, I did not have the time to go into that. If you want, I can discuss it. This will require a little more time. I can discuss with you separately.
Or it can form on any other?
So, till now, they are only, this is the first instance where we are showing that these kind of lipid rafts are there on phagosomes. Nobody has said that before. Probably they are also formed on endosomes because there are many things similar between these two, but other organelles, I don't know. They are normally spoken in the context of the plasma membrane, right? In terms of intercellular organelles having these kind of domains, hardly anything is known. So we had a hard time convincing people that this exists in intercellular organelles also.
But in this case, if there has to be something specific to be added, means why should it form only when on these? Because if this is a random event, then for any organelle, they would tend to land up with more dynein and...
No, because the lipid content is very different from other organelles.
Okay,
it will not fuse with anything else.
Okay, all right.
In the picture, you just showed lysosomes very in close vicinity to the nucleus.
Yes.
This kind of arrangement would really be existing in the cell, or because usually
you imagine lysosomes. You can, this I have exaggerated here a little bit. You will see lysosomes in there, but the large majority is close to the nucleus. It is not sitting at the periphery.
Because they usually don't show it this way in the pictures.
No, so this is a drawing. So yeah. It's not a picture. Yeah, it's not a real picture.
It's a very interesting scenario. I mean, if this happens to be true, what you're proposing and what I've done, that basically the dynein concentration with help of cholesterol can be one of the primary factors to target to the lysosomes.
Right.
I mean, interesting in the sense because then it can be a very well mechanism for innate, not specific to a pathogen, but be a general mechanism for a cell to take care of all pathogenic infections.
It is, actually.
And
it
in
is.
That case, altering that,
yes,
would become very extremely in terms of
no,
curative.
Because our experiments are not done with a real pathogen. They are just done with any benign, inert plastic bead.
Yeah.
It is happening on that. Others have shown that this kind of an accumulation of, not directly, but a particular protein which has affinity to cholesterol, you can see that forming on the surface of Leishmania particles. Mm-hmm. In fact, what I did not go into that, I could show in this, we published that Leishmania actually disrupts these clusters. Okay, we could show that.
Well, that's the implication is very profound in terms of a treatment of a pathological.
Yeah, you will see.
It's very generalized, because then you can have a very generalized treatment against all the infections.
No, in fact, it is known, and this is, it is not so much informed, that people who go to hospitals and get hospital infections, many people who take statins, who have low cholesterol, are more statistically more prone to hospital infections. Okay. Whether it is because of this or not, of course.
Excuse me. For the switch to happen, you said one option was removal of the kinesin. But you said
the
that's
kinesin
not
is
possible.
Actually not removed here.
Yeah, but why that happens?
Why kinesin is not removed?
Yeah.
So Okay, so there are two ways of doing the switch. One is you remove kinesin, the other is you add dyne. Okay, now turns out that the surface area of this, if I assume it to be a sphere, it need not be exact sphere, but it will go as the square of the dimension. Okay, but and you can calculate this contact area, it is about 3 to 4% of the total surface area. Now suppose I randomly throw, suppose I have to increase the number of dynes. But when I increase it, what fraction will come into this area? It is going to be about 4%, a very small fraction, okay? So because it is goes as the square, so therefore to now have 6 more dynes on that, 4% out of that 6 will go there, right? So it is not a feasible mechanism to do this. A more feasible mechanism is to change the geometrical organization of this. So in fact, between this and this, there is no difference that we can detect between kinesin and dynein numbers. But so, you know, exactly how this has happened back in evolution, I can't say. I can just argue on the basis of, you know, yeah.
Is anything known about how the pathogens can prevent that effect from happening?
This?
So yeah, I mean, to prevent dynein from accumulating.
Yeah, so that's what I was saying. So since you asked, I will say a little bit more on that. What we did is that we were specifically interested in a pathogen called Leishmania. Okay. Leishmaniasis is Kala-Azar, very dangerous disease. But what we showed is that, so suppose you have this phagosome on which you have these cholesterol patches and you have these motors here, what we could do is that we could purify a particular lipid from this pathogen, okay? We didn't purify it, somebody else purified and gave it to us, and this, I can never remember the name of that lipid, but doesn't matter, okay, lipid L, and this lipid has lots of phosphate groups on it, okay? Lipophosphoglycans, yeah. This has, it's a glycolipid, it has lots of phosphate groups on it. Each phosphate group brings in negative charge, PO4, it brings in negative charge. And this lipid also has a part which kind of injects it into this here. It likes cholesterol. So now you can imagine when Leishmania infects, you will have, over and above dynein, you will have lots of these lipids stuck here. Okay? And people believe, there is no hard evidence for this, is that when these lipids get stuck here, they bring in a huge amount of negative charge into this region. And that electrostatically destabilizes this region. We could actually show that when you have this lipid, these clusters are visibly distributed like this. Okay, we could show that. Okay, so that may be, and these things don't move then. Okay, so that may be one mechanism by which Leishmania avoids, you know, going here. Now, then again, these pathogens, they are not one-trick ponies. They do many things to disrupt. The successful ones do many things.
Other questions? Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. If not, let's thank Professor Malik again. And so there is a tea break now, and we'll start the formal function at 11:30. I have one announcement to make for the students. When you check out of the hostel, so a security guard will come to your room and check the room before you can leave the key. So please allow time for that and be patient while they do this. Okay? Thank you. Okay, let's go and have tea outside.